This video is supported by viewers like you. If you too want to help me make more things like this, consider supporting me on Patreon. Thank you. 9th of July, 2010. Two airplanes land around noon at Vienna International Airport. One plane comes from New York, the other from Moscow. From both planes, people emerge who get transported in a black van from one to the other. After 90 minutes, this whole procedure is complete, and both planes travel homewards. But nobody knows at this point, the thing that just took place oh so quietly was the biggest Russian-American prisoner exchange since the Cold War. Those prisoners, however, were not inside for breaking open a chewing gum machine, rather because of high treason. 14 persons, all at least under suspicion of espionage, are traded by two superpowers like baseball cards. And for that, they fly to Austria? Weird, isn't it? After all, we're talking about a country populated by only a proud 1,000th of all humans on Earth that's so insignificant, its self-conception as rival to Germany is only met with confused laughter. Nevertheless, this land of mountains, land on the stream, makes for a popular playground for intelligence services from every corner of the planet. For prisoner exchanges, eavesdropping, or handover of mysterious suitcases. Says not only I, but also the Austrian Office for the Protection of the Constitution and Counter-Terrorism. The fact that, in this little heap of soil, you do not expect a stupefying number of international intelligence services may be excused, since, as an espionage target, Austria itself is really only semi-exciting. But from within Austria, many other countries and institutions can be easily spied upon, and there's a few reasons for that. Austria lies right in the center of Europe, has a well-functioning infrastructure, allowing quick movement in and out, is politically stable, ensuring law and order is upheld, has a spy-friendly legal framework, more on that in a few minutes, perpetual neutrality, prohibiting military alliances, and a none-of-my-business kind of politics that reduces nosy questions to a minimum. Thus, more than enough reasons to choose Austria for a business trip. And since there's not much spying to be done among cows and grapevines, your best bet is the federal and espionage capital, Vienna, where a spy in retirement can even make it to mayor. Espionage-wise, Vienna only really takes off from 1945 onwards. After a 7-year episode of megalomania and German co-production, Austria is once again reduced to its manageable size and generously quartered by the occupation forces. France picks up Vorarlberg and Tyrol, the UK gets East Tyrol, Carinthia and Styria, the US takes Salzburg and Upper Austria, and the Soviet Union gets Lower Austria and, presumably because it lies in the east, not because nobody else wanted it, the land of castles, one of a kind, Burgenland. And Vienna, Vienna, you alone, shall have all four on your throne. Everyone grabs a few districts, and the old town is jointly governed by the Allied Quartet, like one big, ideologically hostile family. However, fighting one world war against the same Chaplin imitator doesn't mean you're best friends afterwards. I too am all for the market economy and personal freedoms and all that rubbish. That's great to hear.
I'm not entirely certain, but I think he's lying.
Well then, now that we're best buds, let's hear how one builds a nuclear bomb. The geopolitical situation was still very tense. So, as occupying power you thought, since we're already hanging out at the banks of the beautiful blue, well, grey-green Danube, we should make the most of our stay and keep tabs on potential future adversaries. For that, they didn't just employ their own personnel, but also ordinary Austrians, who, lacking any real secret information, simply took what they read in the newspaper and sold it for a few shillings or a bottle of moonshine to inquisitive intelligence officers. And thus, spies scurry the streets of Vienna undisturbed, until 1955, when Austria gets its state treaty, pronouncing it free, democratic, and by its own volition, neutral, although that is, strictly speaking, not part of the treaty. The spying doesn't stop there though. Since Cold War, East vs. West, that's when the feelings of Allied unity are over for good. And to Felix Austria, situated right next to the Iron Curtain, squished between NATO and the regrettably flagless Warsaw Pact, provided a good opportunity to spy on the enemy on safe ground. But since all the soldiers were already back home, one had to figure out a different way to get their people into Austria. Fortunately, more and more embassies and international organizations kept popping up in Vienna, which were not only targets for intelligence collection, but also a great way to put spies in place. And that went as follows. You send, let's say, 6 diplomats to Vienna, 4 of which will actually work in the embassy, leaving 2 agents with diplomat camouflage who can spy around to their heart's content. And because they're protected by the Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations from the anger of states and their short-fused rulers, they are, no matter how badly they misbehave, legally untouchable, because diplomatic immunity. Worst case scenario, you're found to be a persona non grata and stuck into a plane back home. The whole thing goes as far as countries which cannot punish diplomats for exceeding the speed limit or parking like madmen, amicably asking diplomats to pretty please with sugar on top, pay their fines. And honor where it's due, in Austria, more than one third actually does just that. But even without the magic words, diplomatic immunity, spies in Austria have little to worry about, as long as they don't work against their host. Let me repeat that. Espionage in Austria is legal, comma, unless it is directed against the Republic of Austria. But before you start laying fiber optic cables and purchasing night vision goggles to further the intelligence capabilities of the Principality of Sealand, take note that if you establish, operate or support a military intelligence service on Austrian territory, no matter who you're targeting, that can still land you in jail. Only the prison term of 2 years max seems a little pathetic, considering that uncovered spies elsewhere eat a healthy dose of polonium flakes for breakfast. In the last few decades, a lot has changed. But only because today, 2 minutes from the Red Square, there's a McDonald's, doesn't mean that there's now fewer spies in Vienna than deep sea divers in your village pond. The Iron Curtain went, the spies stayed. In the meantime, Brussels has, thanks to its EU capital bonus, long passed Vienna in spy activity. But rest easy, little Austrian soul, Vienna is still important. Depending on the source, there are still 6, 7, 8,000 or more foreign spies in Vienna at all times. For a population of less than 2 million, not bad. Unfortunately, those numbers are based on one vague estimate of one intelligence expert who brought forth no clues as to how he'd arrived at 6 to 8,000, which is why you can take that information, put it in a box, stick that into a rocket, and fly to the moon, for it is no more useful up there than for me writing this very script. We have no idea how many spies sneak around Vienna, because they, surprise, try their best to act in secrecy. I, for one, have never heard of someone entering spy as their current occupation. You see, a topic like espionage, which earns many whispers but few words, is inherently a tough thing to research. Even when you laboriously gather a few shreds of information, they often cannot be put together to form a coherent picture. Example: when in 2012 a Libyan ex-prime minister goes for a late night walk in Vienna and ends up being found in the morning floating on the New Danube with more water than air in his lungs, that can have a few reasons. Maybe he went for a cheeky splash, got a cramp in his legs and went under. Or maybe he was, for one of the 1000 reasons, a former advisor to the dictator who fled the country during the revolution, has accumulated over the years, brought to silence. Or maybe he just slipped, fell in and drowned. All possible. Only the information is lacking, and thus it remains a guessing game. Therefore, the standard espionage conclusion applies: I don't know. Mostly though, things don't go down all that violently. You may have an image of espionage in your head, where agents steal top secret documents, neutralize people on a daily basis, and finally zip away with the help of a paraglider. Alas, reality makes that James Bond fantasy into a 5-hour theater performance. Mostly, it's all about collecting information, about politics, the economy, and security, but also everything else that might be of some use. Which champagne does the ambassador prefer? Where does he go for dinner? Does he have a fling or a secret affinity for model railways? Stuff like that. Meaning, you take everything you can get, raise a mountain of trash, and when the time's right, take out one or two relevant details. But hold on, why is Austria letting foreign powers mess about on its sovereign territory in the first place? Well, let's ask that differently. What can Austria do to stop it? Other countries don't ask nicely before sending over spies. Sure, you could resist by uncovering spies or sending them back home, but that only spells diplomatic trouble, provided there even is a sufficient budget for the pipe dream effective counterintelligence. It's not like Austria raised its hand when important functions in global intelligence operations were passed out, but that's the way it is now, so it might be best to just make the most out of it. Espionage is a business. Make no fuss and you get a reward. Every time a seriously flushed spy is sipping on a glass of red wine, the host gets a generous tip, and diplomatic relationships unexpectedly flourish when you turn your head and look away. Yes, espionage is a crooked game, but those who don't play along have already lost.